Thank you for joining us tonight. So, beloved, Tuesdays are the times when we meet to just learn as disciples of Jesus Christ. We sit under the tutelage of the Holy Spirit, and we trust that, like before and even better, He is going to teach us more and we'll live with a great depth of understanding. I would like for us to just grab our communing elements tonight as we get ready to partake of the Lord's Supper together. Amen. Today, we will continue with the mystery of understanding in the kingdom. And this is part two of a series we began last week. And of course, our base text is taken from Luke 24, from verse 44 to 45. I read to us from the New King James Version. The Bible says, "Then he said to them," talking about Jesus, "these are the words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms concerning me. And he opened their understanding that they might comprehend the scriptures." Amen. So that remains our base text for this series until we complete the series. Now, in the meantime, as we partake of the Lord's Supper, I would like for us to read from Mark 15, verse 16 to 20. Amen. I'll read this to us from the New International Version. The Bible says, "The soldiers led Jesus away into the palace," that is the praetorium, "and called together the whole company of soldiers. They put a purple robe on him, then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on him. And they began to call out to him, 'Hail, King of the Jews!' Again and again they struck him on the head with a staff and spit on him. Falling on their knees, they paid homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they laid him out to crucify him." Amen. So, beloved, we see an account of part of the events that took place in the life of Jesus Christ. And the Bible took time through the Gospels to narrate to us the different things that were done to the body of Jesus, the different aspects of his body that was broken, because we know that his body was broken, not his bones. In this particular excerpt from Mark 15, 16 to 20, we see how his head was broken in that sense, how the body that surrounded his head was broken, meaning that the skin opened up. Why? Because the crown of thorns was forced to the head of Jesus Christ. And when you look throughout scriptures and examine the different areas that his body was tortured, you realize that every body part was touched. Amen. But tonight, we want to focus on the head. Why? Because in the head, we have the brain. And through the brain, it's through the brain that we are able to grasp information and gain understanding to a place where our mind begins to comprehend it at a whole new level. Beloved, when we study the word of God, we need a degree of functionality when it comes to our heads and our brains. So tonight we have seen a situation whereby Jesus Christ allowed his head to go through a situation so that your head will not have to suffer a form of injury to the place where it hinders you from using the parts of your head or within your head, meaning your brain. And because you will need all of those for the understanding of his word. Amen. So I want us to use this opportunity tonight, even as we break bread, symbolizing that the head of Jesus Christ was broken, the skin and the parts inside were affected. I just want us to use this opportunity and call upon us on this line. I'll say, everyone, if you do have a head condition physically, I want you to lay it, direct it to the head of Jesus, because his head suffered a situation so that yours and mine will not have to go through it. Is it the aspect of understanding as a whole, be it physical or spiritual things, your inability to do so? I pray tonight that even as we break bread, I want you to see the head of Jesus Christ carrying those situations so that yours can function like it is meant to function in this day and age. Amen. The Bible tells us that Jesus wore the crown of thorns. Today, what does your head wear and what does my head wear? Our heads wear the helmet of salvation. While Jesus Christ wore the crown of thorns, he wore it in exchange so that you and I can wear the helmet of salvation. It was in the pursuit of salvation that Jesus Christ wore the crown of thorns. So today that mission has been accomplished so that in exchange for the crown of thorns, everything that torments your mind and your physical head, today, and I guarantee you that we have the hope of salvation as a helmet according to scripture. So as you break that bread, remind yourself that tonight you're exchanging the crown of thorns which you have carried in exchange for the helmet of salvation, which is your hope. So tonight I want us to lift up that bread and just thank God that Jesus Christ had to endure wearing the helmet of salvation so that in this day and age, beginning now, in exchange for the torments of my mind and my physical head, I exchange it for the helmet of salvation, which is my hope. Father, we thank you because there is hope in you. The things that torment us physically and spiritually, we do not need to own those things because Jesus Christ took ownership of them on the cross. So tonight as a family, we redirect the torment of the head, physically and spiritually, to the head of Jesus Christ. And in exchange of that, we put on, by faith, the helmet of salvation. And we declare everything in our heads restored, be it physically and spiritually. Our ability to understand, oh God, is being restored even tonight. Our ability to comprehend physical and spiritual truths are being restored even tonight in the name of Jesus. As we break this bread, we see all our challenges in our heads being placed upon the head of Jesus, the broken body of Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. So tonight, beloved, let's just break the bread together. It's important to break it, amen, because it symbolizes that which Jesus Christ had to endure. And in exchange of that, we receive wholeness in our minds. In Jesus' name, amen. So let's partake together. As we hold a cup of blessing in our hands, whatever we hold, be it juice or water, it is symbolic to us as the blood of Jesus Christ. So we say, thank you, Father, for that which we hold in our hands, and we declare that it is the blood of Jesus. Now, Hebrews 10 verse 19 says something very intriguing. It says, and so, dear brothers and sisters, we can now boldly enter enter heaven's most holy place because of the blood of Jesus. Amen. I'll read this again. It says, and so, dear brothers and sisters, we can boldly enter heaven's most holy place because of the blood of Jesus. What does that tell us? It says we can enter a place, the holy place, the Bible calls it the most holy place. And the what makes it possible for us to gain access to that place is the blood of Jesus. In other words, the blood of Jesus grants us access into places that we will not otherwise gain access to, void of the blood of Jesus. Amen. So tonight, as we partake of the blood of Jesus, I want us to declare that we are gaining access into the most holy place of God. In the most holy place of God, you gain access to the mysteries of God. You gain access to the mind of God per time, amen? You gain access to the mind of God. You can accurately hear the heartbeat of God and communicate it to your family, to the people who look up to you, amen? So tonight, we just want to thank God for access. That God has not hidden things from us. He has hidden them for us. And today he's giving us a key that there is a way you can access those things that I have in store for you. And you can do so by virtue of the blood of Jesus. So we have a reason to thank God for the blood of Jesus tonight. We thank him tonight for access. Access into the deep things of God, access into the deep place of God, access into the deep understanding and mysteries of God, access to understanding that God is everything Amen. So, Father, we say thank you for the cup that we hold in our hands. We declare that it is the blood of Jesus. And as we partake of it by faith, we declare that we are gaining access into places that we will not otherwise gain access to. And this is only possible through the blood of Jesus. We thank you for grace in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So let's partake together with that understanding and by faith. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Good evening, beloved. Hope everyone is doing well.
Good evening. Thank you.
Brother Allen. Mm-hmm. To everyone, Brother Amel, Sister Benna, Sister Christine, good evening to you all. Sister Desiree, Brother Kevin, Sister Miranda, Sister Pony, Brother Prince, and Pastor Kwame. You're all welcome once again to tonight's session. Amen. So, beloved, continue with our series. Amen. Last week, we began talking about the mystery of understanding, and we looked at several aspects of it. So tonight, I want us to continue on that same subject matter by looking at the benefits of understanding. Amen. What are the benefits of understanding in the kingdom? Because if it's not beneficial, why bother talking about it? But it is because it's beneficial. That's why we are spending weeks and days of studies to just understand what understanding is in the kingdom. Amen. Now, the first two benefits which I would like us to take a look at tonight is the fact that the Lord rejoices when we understand, and we are strengthened when the Lord, when we understand. Amen. We are strengthened in that process when we understand. Now, these two points, we're going to read them from the book of Nehemiah, chapter 8, from verse 7 to 10. And I'll read this to us from the Message translation. Remember, again, we are looking at the fact that the Lord rejoices and we are strengthened, amen, when we understand. Now, the Bible says, Jeshua, Bani, Sherebia, Jamin, Akub, Shebathai, Hodiah, Messai, Kelita, Azariah, Josabad, Hanan, and Peliah, all Levites, explained the revelation while people stood listening respectfully. We are told that they translated the book of the revelation of God, meaning the scriptures, so the people could understand it, and then explained the reading. Amen. So we see that Levites, people who were set aside to work in the temple, and their names all listed, the Bible says that they took time to explain the book of Revelation to the people, amen, so that the people could understand what was being read to them. Now, verse 9 now says that Nehemiah, the governor, along with Ezra, the priest and scholar, and the Levites who were teaching the people, said to all the people, "This day is holy to God, your God. Don't weep and carry on." They said this because all the people were weeping as they heard the words of the revelation. He continued, "Go home and prepare a feast, holiday food and drink, and share it with those who don't have anything. This day is holy to God. Don't feel bad. The joy of God is your strength." Amen. Beloved, if you've ever taken the time to study the book of Nehemiah, and especially chapter 8, you realize that Ezra, who we had once talked about to be a teacher of the law, and Nehemiah, the one who came to build the walls in Jerusalem, at this point, the wall had been built, and they were trying to bring structure to that environment once again. Now, they needed to restore the book of the law, the scriptures, back to the people. However, it took Levites to explain to the people the word of God, because they had lost it for so long. So someone needed to take time to explain it to them. Now, the Bible now tells us that after they had explained all of these things to them, the people began to cry. They were not crying out of sorrow. They were crying because they had now received restoration of something which was once lost. Secondly, they were crying because they had received understanding. They did not just appreciate the fact that they had the scrolls with them and someone reading it to them, but they were happy that they could understand it during that season. And as a result, tears of joy flowed out of their eyes. But the people, the Levites, their leaders encouraged them that, you know what, it is time to rejoice, to not be sad. Go home and celebrate this holy day, the day that the Lord has restored to you understanding, the day that the Lord has restored to you the scrolls of his word, the law. Amen. And then at the end, it says, this day is holy to God. Don't feel bad. Then it says, the joy of God is your strength. Why is the joy of God our strength? The Lord rejoices when we understand. Amen. Amen. When we understand scriptures, God rejoices. And when God rejoices, you and I are strengthened. That's what the scripture means. Amen. When God rejoices, you are strengthened. Meaning that if you find yourself in weakness, what we should be doing is seeking to understand scripture, what God has to say, or what the word of God has to say. When we understand it, our Father in heaven rejoices that his children have understood. And when he rejoices, it gives you and I strength. It's such a mystery, I cannot explain it any further, but that's what the word of God says. And beloved, when you try it, you'll believe this truth. Amen. It will become your reality. Where do we sometimes lose strength? We sometimes lose strength when we are not able to figure out situations in life. And each and every one of us on this line tonight, myself included, there are areas in our lives that we are not able to figure out. And what does that do to you and I? It makes us lose strength. It makes us just look at everything to be so sad, so discouraged. And you know how negative energy drains us. But the moment the light of God shines in that area, you realize that your strength is restored. Amen. When the Lord rejoices, because of our understanding, we are strengthened. Amen. So it is imperative that we seek understanding with everything that we have, that we go after understanding with everything that we have, because lack of understanding, beloved, is costly. Amen. Lack of understanding is very costly. It will cost you even your very life. Amen. So let's go out and pursue understanding. Why? Because it's beneficial. It brings us pleasure when God rejoices, I believe. And when God rejoices, the reward for us is that we are strengthened. Amen. It's always best for us to be in our strongest position all the time. And that way we guard ourselves against the strikes of the enemy, if I may say. Amen. Now, the third reason why understanding is beneficial is because we are blessed. Scripture simply states it. It says in Proverbs 3:13, that blessed is the one who finds wisdom and the one who gets understanding. In other words, if you read this as thus, blessed is the one who gets understanding. Amen. We thank God for those who find the wisdom, but we also want to thank God for those who gain the understanding, because they are equally blessed. It is one thing to pursue wisdom, it's another thing to pursue understanding. And in both pursuits, we are all blessed. Amen. And we believe that we want to be blessed. I believe that you want to be blessed because I want to be blessed. One of the areas that we can tap the blessings of God from is in the area of understanding. Amen. So in your list of things that bring blessings to you, I want you to add understanding to it and begin to apply it to your life so that you satisfy all the conditions for receiving the blessing of the Lord. Amen. The fourth point is established. When we receive understanding, one of the benefits is that we are established. Amen. We are established. Amen. The Bible says in Proverbs 3:13, I think I got that. Proverbs 3:19. Okay, not 13. Here is the typo. Proverbs 3:19. The Bible says, the Lord by wisdom founded the earth. By understanding, he established the heavens. Amen. Now we're talking about God, our Father here. Look at what he did. Because you know that the heavens and the earth were created by by faith. Amen. So when he asked us to live by faith, he also demonstrated the faith. Amen. But in this particular scenario, we are told that the Lord, by wisdom, founded the earth. So finding the earth or establishing the earth is one thing, or gaining an understanding of creating the earth is one thing, but establishing the various functions of the earth, as in, you know, separating the light from the darkness and the day from night and the fish in the sea and the birds in the air and creatures walking on the earth, that required understanding. All of those things were established once and for all by understanding. And we are talking about God Almighty, amen. Our God Almighty, he founded earth using wisdom. However, he established the different functionalities of the earth by understanding. What does that tell us? Meaning that void of understanding, we cannot establish. Meaning that we can have the wisdom of the Lord. We can have this book all loaded in our heads. We know it. Now, to make what we know a reality is what we are talking about, establishment. Amen. We know that the Word of God, in the Word of God, access can be gained. Yet in the physical, we do not have access to anything, be it access to destiny helpers, be it access to good relationships, be it access to mysteries of the kingdom. All of those things and more are just not in our forefront. We just cannot gain access to them. We just cannot benefit from them. Yet we know that the Word of God says so. Beloved, is going to take the spirit of understanding to take those mysteries or those things from within us to establish it, and it becomes our reality. To know that it is beneficial to have destiny helpers is wisdom, but to actually experience the hands of destiny helpers is understanding. That's simply what we are saying, amen. Knowing something is one thing, making it your reality is another thing. That is the difference between wisdom versus understanding, amen. That's what we are talking about tonight. So, yes, we thank God that we are Bible students. Yes, we thank God that we love the Word of God. But the question tonight is that, what have we established by virtue of what we know? What has become our reality? Because we saw it in the Word of God, and through that wisdom, we came now and walked it out, and it is now very tangible. Because your wisdom will remain in the realm of the unforeseen, but your understanding is what would take your wisdom from that realm into the realm of reality and make it tangible, even to your viewers. Amen. Proverbs 24, verse 3 to 4 now talks about you and I. In Proverbs 3:19, it talked about the Lord and understanding. And now this is about us. It says, through wisdom, a house is built. And by understanding, it is established. By knowledge, the rooms are filled with all precious and pleasant riches. Amen. It is the same idea. We can build a house, but to establish that house takes the understanding of the Lord. What does it take to establish a house to a home? It takes your understanding of the mysteries of God. Because I can come to your building and your building is a house, but never a home. It takes understanding to transition your house to a home. Amen. So the question we should be asking ourselves is, what have we gained from the Word of God to the place where we have now established in that house, to a place where that house has now become a home? Amen. It is understanding that makes all the difference. Amen. Otherwise, your house can become a jungle. But understanding can change your house from a jungle to a haven of peace. It takes understanding to make your house a home. Amen. It takes understanding for you to establish spiritual principles in your home until they become a reality. I remember on Sunday, our sister Bernadette was giving a testimony and saying that in her house, there'll be no argument. It takes understanding to get to that place. Amen. it takes understanding to establish that principle. Amen. What are the things that you have established in your house that has now made it a home that is cozy and inviting to the people who walk into it? Is it have you taken times to nurture the presence of God in your home to a place where when people get in there, the atmosphere is completely different? Beloved, more than wisdom, understanding is needed to establish those realities in your very living space. Amen. We're looking at the benefits of understanding. We'll take a look at one more. Guidance, amen, meaning protection. When we gain understanding, we can benefit from protection. Proverbs 2 verse 11, I'll read to us from two translations, the English Standard Version and the Passion Translation. The Bible says, discretion will watch over you. Understanding will guard you, amen. In the TPT, it says, if you choose to follow good counsel, divine design will watch over you, and understanding will protect you from making poor choices. Understanding will protect you from making poor choices. Amen. I believe that's really straightforward. Understanding will help us and prevent us and protect us from making poor choices. Are we prone to poor choices, even mistakenly? It's a report card of our lack of understanding. No offense, we are all on a journey. We are growing, but until we face the truth and address it as is, then we'll forever be hiding things under the rug and never address them, and then we'll never be delivered from that realm. Amen. So examine yourself. Are you benefiting from understanding? We have looked at five, I believe, benefits of understanding, that the Lord rejoices. Does it do you good when the Lord rejoices? Absolutely. It does us good when he rejoices because we are strengthened. So more reasons why we should seek those benefits, seek to understand. Do you and I want to be blessed? Absolutely. Do we want to be established? Most likely we want to be established because God himself established, amen, and he used understanding as the tool to establish himself. And the fifth point, I believe there are more in scriptures, but this is just helping us to open up our eyes to this area of understanding. Guidance, amen. Protection. Are we prone to poor choices? Maybe not. Maybe we are. But let's work on our understanding for the glory of the Lord. Amen. Now, we are going to now take a look at reasons for concealed understanding. Last week, we examined quite a few scriptures that talked about that understanding can be concealed. And if I remember well, we talked about the situation of the Ethiopian eunuch. We talked about the disciples whose eyes were restrained. You know, and then we talked about Proverbs 25 verse 2, that it's the glory of God to conceal the matter and the glory of kings to, you know, open it up to them to find it. And then we also looked at the fact that in Matthew 13, when Jesus began to speak in parables, you know, he did so because of the Pharisees and Sadducees who called him Beelzebub. So he began to conceal that information, the information of the kingdom, to a place where his disciples asked him that, why are you now speaking in parables? And he explained it to them. Amen. Now, tonight I want us to look at reasons for concealed understanding. Amen. What are some of the reasons that we find in scriptures? We're going to go as far as we can for tonight. Now, the first point here is inability to understand, maybe due to language barrier or age. Amen. Because communication is not complete until the other person really understands you. Amen. It's not really complete until the other person truly understands you. Now, one of the things, areas that the Bible identifies for the reasons for concealed understanding is the aspect of language barrier, or I want to say age. Now, in Nehemiah chapter 8, we're going to read from verse 1 all the way to verse 6. Amen. From verse 1 to verse 6, the Bible says here that now all the people gathered together. Remember, we talked about this earlier. We said that when the walls were rebuilt, the people had to restore the scrolls, the law, back to the people. And then the leaders had to restore, the Levites had to restore the scroll back to the people, which is the law of God. And they had to explain it to them. But look at the conditions, the things that they considered to make sure that understanding was actually gained in the process. Amen. The Bible says that now all the people gathered together as one man in the open square that was in front of the water gate. And they told Ezra the scribe to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded Israel. Amen. So the people gathered together in a particular place, just like we have all gathered here tonight by Zoom for the purpose of listening to the word of God. And they had a specific people who are to bring this law to them. So the Bible says in verse 2 that, so Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly of men and women, and all who could hear with understanding. All who could hear with understanding on the first day of the seventh month. Then the Bible says, then he read from it in the open square that was in front of the water gates from morning until midday before the men and women and those who could understand, amen, those who could understand. And the Bible says, and the ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. So they did not just bring this law in front of people randomly. They chose the people who could understand. And there was a reason for that, because it was a mixed crowd. If you could read this particular verse 2, for example, in the New Living Translation, the Bible specifically says this. It says, so on October 8th, Ezra the priest brought the book of the law before the assembly, which included the men and the women and all the children old enough to understand. Here it says, all who could hear with understanding. Amen. So, beloved, it's one thing to bring the word of God to people, but you want to understand your crowd as much as it depends on you. Amen. You want to understand your crowd to a place where you can cater to both the sheep and the giraffe. Amen. God can give you wisdom to find an in-between such that you cater to both extremes. It's not enough to just bring the word, but it's necessary to examine your crowd, know the condition of your flock, so that when you bring the word of God to them, you know that you can cater to both the sheep and the giraffe, like we have said. And then it is also your responsibility. We are leaders, so I'm speaking to us as leaders. It is also our responsibility to examine the crowd and also maybe separate the crowd, amen, the children from the adults, so that the children can receive the word of God at their level so that they can understand. It is one thing to hear the Bible play, but it's another thing for somebody to understand it. And you know, a five-year-old may not understand what you and I understand. And that is why somehow there is a way that you have to communicate it to them using maybe a different kind of vocabulary so that they understand. This, the priests and the Levites then understood this. So they brought that law, meaning their Bible, before the assembly of men and women and all who could understand. Here it says, and all the children old enough to understand. And of course, they read it to them. And it goes on. This part is not very necessary for this particular point, but in your own spare time, I would like you to read all the way to verse 6. But here, what are we saying? The inability to understand due to language barrier or age. Amen. Understanding can be concealed because of language barrier and because of age. And that is why in some settings they have interpreters. Amen. So now you know that the role of interpreters are very important, because it will not benefit people to come to church and clearly tell you and I that we don't understand this language and then we do nothing about it. If you're unable to do something about it within your own circle, it will be best to refer them to a circle where their needs can be catered for, amen, so that their understanding doesn't remain concealed forever because of a language barrier or because of age. If you have children in your midst, you want to maybe create a sector for them or a section for them whereby they can learn at their level until they get to maturity and can chew the same things that you and I can chew. Amen. Now, the second reason why understanding can be concealed is lack of help. Still looking at Nehemiah chapter 8, from verse 7 to 8, the Bible says something. It says, also, Jeshua, Bani, Sheribia, Jamin, Akub, Shabethe, Hodija, Mesai, Kelita, Azaria, Josabad, Hanan, Heliah, and the Levites helped the people to understand the law, and the people stood in their place. Here is the key. These priests, these Levites, helped the people to understand the law. Verse 8 says, so they read distinctly from the book in the law of God, and they gave the sense and helped them to understand the reading. Sometimes, beloved, in this journey of understanding the word of God, we will all need help, amen. The help may not be as much when you get to a certain stage, because your understanding has been unveiled by the Holy Spirit to a place where you quickly get it. But until then, you and I need the help. And I want to say, do not shy away from receiving that help. If you do not open up yourself to receive the help that you need to move you from where you are to the next level, then you will perpetually be handicapped in the area of understanding. Amen. It's a mystery, it's a spirit. Understanding in the world is not the same as understanding spiritual things. Along this journey, allow people to hold your hands at different stages to get you to a place where you do understand. Amen. And until Jesus comes, there will always be something that we need understanding with. And do not shy away from receiving help. The people, the Israelites here, were helped by the Levites to understand the law. They were helped to understand the reading. And I submit to us that in this day and age, including now, you and I need help in understanding many things in the book of the law, in scriptures, amen. And please do not shy away from receiving that help. Otherwise, your understanding in that area will always be concealed, amen. But that does not bring joy to God, amen, amen. Okay, so number three, the third reason why understanding is concealed is because understanding is costly and not everybody is willing to pay the price. Amen. You know, in the kingdom or the lifestyle of the kingdom almost seems, or I should say, is like swimming against the tide. It's unfortunate that majority are swimming, you know, in the way of the world, the standards of the world, but very few are swimming in the direction of the kingdom. And you realize that when you choose to swim in the direction of the kingdom, it feels like swimming against the tide because it's not a natural stream of flow. Amen. It's not the natural. It's like you're fighting against the odds to move in the opposite direction, which is actually the right direction. Amen. But many are so lost and they don't see the reason to flow in the direction that you and I are flowing in. And as a result, it's costly to you who chooses to swim against the tide. What does it cost you? It costs you your reputation. People will mock at you. They say, oh, the Bible girl or the Jesus girl and the Jesus boy. They'll call you names. Amen, they will. They will snub at you. They will say things against you. It will cost you your finances. It will cost you your time. It will cost you many other resources that I don't even know. But depending on your own situation and the country in which you live in, it will be very costly. It will cost your self-image. But beloved, I want to encourage us that it's all for a good cause. Amen. It's all for a good cause. Now, Proverbs 4, verse 7 says this in the Passion Translation and the NIV. It says, wisdom is the most valuable commodity. So buy it. Amen. Wisdom is valuable. So the Bible says buy it. That doesn't sound like a suggestion. It says buy it. It's an instruction. Buy wisdom. Now it says revelation knowledge, which is what we seek to get out of the wisdom we acquire, is what you need, is what I need. Amen. Then the Bible says, so invest in it. Not a suggestion. It's an instruction. Amen. So invest in it. Invest in it. You invest your rest time. You invest your finances. You invest your leisure time. You invest time with your family. You invest so much to make this a reality. I can guarantee you, you will not become a couch potato and get these things. God will not even make sure that you get it. He will not. Guaranteed, he wouldn't. Amen. You will have to show a degree of interest to gain access to the mysteries of God. Amen. It is that valuable to him, to a place where he tells us that it is what we need, so we need to invest in it. You can lie on your couch and read your Bible from Genesis to Revelation. That is wonderful. But if you must gain access to mysteries, you have to change the rules of engagement. Totally, you have to change them. Amen. NIV says the beginning of wisdom is this, get wisdom. And it says, though it costs all you have, get understanding. Why? The Bible is acknowledging that it will cost you. Therefore, those who will not be willing to pay the price, then they will not gain the understanding. Amen. So that could be one reason why understanding becomes concealed, because all that is needed and required of you to go after it to a place where you get it, you are not willing to pay the price. So in that area, we remain concealed. Amen. But it is not the Lord's perfect will for you and I. The fourth reason is laziness or impatience. Amen. Laziness or impatience. In Proverbs 25:2, we've talked about this a lot. It says, it is the glory of God to conceal a matter. To search out a matter is the glory of kings. And I looked up the definition of search, because it says we should search it out. And it says to try to find something by looking or otherwise seeking carefully and thoroughly. Amen. Think about how when you get a job that pays you really well, how you take time to go through your job description. For every point that is listed on that job description, you take your time so that you can be in right standing with your company. Amen. The question is, do you do the same when it comes to the precepts of the kingdom? Do we take time to understand verse after verse, chapter after chapter, book after book, knowing that our life depends on this? Do we take time to search out scriptures? We give our best to what really doesn't matter as much. Because, beloved, it is because God has given you air that is why you can even get a job. Void of life, everything comes to a standstill. Amen. So I'm calling upon us to reprioritize. Amen. Reprioritize your priorities. The areas that you really need to devote time, where you'll be rewarded by the Almighty God, is the area that you should be investing your best in. And then he'll make sure that in the other areas of life, things will move on smoothly than you expect. So a place where your mistakes become a blessing. Believe me when I say so. When you walk with the Holy Spirit, when you take time to search out scriptures, your mistakes become a blessing. As a matter of fact, they become what you're looking out for, because the Lord is with you. Amen. So we will have to lay aside laziness and impatience for the things of the kingdom. Because I want to say that I don't think I have any doubts that any of us are lazy towards pursuing finances and our jobs and our careers. But I'm calling upon us to remember that God is your everything. God is our everything.
Amen. Amen.
Our everything. Amen. So when we take time to search out matters, it will be proof to him that we are not lazy about kingdom pursuits. And then when we don't find it, we will not get impatient in the process. We will keep pursuing, because the Holy Spirit is our teacher. He will lead us to people who will help us. Until we get it, we wouldn't relent for the glory of the Lord. Amen. Amen. Now, Proverbs 2, 1 to 3, I believe we'll be reading to verse 6 actually. It says, my son, if you will receive my words and treasure up my commandments within you. Amen. It says, making your ear attentive to skillful and godly wisdom, and inclining and directing your heart and mind to understanding. Look at this. And inclining and directing your heart and mind to understanding. In other words, applying all your powers to the quest for it. This doesn't seem like some lazy pursuit. It seems like something that you invest time and energy, human resource, your energy, your sleep time, your everything. Amen. It doesn't sound like a lazy person. No lazy person will want to give careful attention to the precepts of God as the word of God describes it here. Then he says, yes, if you cry out for insight and raise your voice for understanding. The Bible says, if you seek wisdom as for silver and search for skillful and godly wisdom as for hidden treasures, this is a guarantee, then you will understand the reverence and worshipful fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of our omniscient God. For the Lord gives skillful and godly wisdom. From his mouth come knowledge and understanding. Amen. Beloved, I believe it's very, very clear, very, very explicit. We will have to lay aside laziness and impatience, and then we will have to carry, understanding as our pursuit by inclining our ears, directing our hearts and our minds to gaining understanding. Meaning whatever it takes, however the Lord leads us to gaining it. It will mean even laying aside your ego. Amen. God may be sending you to somebody way younger than you to teach you what you need to know. I want to say something here, beloved. Your challenge is another person's victory. Amen. The fact that it is difficult for you does not mean it's difficult for everybody in that area.
Amen. So if, amen, Pastor.
To your advantage to say, you know what? I am not making it in this area, but this sister, though younger than me, she's making it. There is something she knows that I do not know. So I'm going to humble myself. I'm going to ask her. And when I receive that wisdom from her and that understanding, by the grace of God, I'm going to break through in the area that has stood like a wall for years. But it will cost you your ego to lay it aside and humble yourself before even a younger person to receive insight. It's a journey to pursue understanding. It's very costly. Very costly. It's time consuming. It will require of you to give your all, to incline and direct your heart and your mind. Everything that it costs you to get it, beloved, because you want the Lord to be happy, you're going to do it. Amen. And when you do so, then the Bible says, because for you to read Proverbs 2 from verse 5, you're doing yourself injustice. You will have to know the conditions that lead to the then. Amen. And part of the conditions is pursuing understanding. Then he says, then you will understand. Amen. The reverent and worshipful fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of our omniscient God. And then it says, for the Lord gives skillful and godly wisdom. From his mouth come knowledge and understanding. There is a place where wisdom and understanding is found, in the hiding place of the glory of God. Amen. Now, the fifth reason why understanding can be concealed is because of our lack of reverence for God. Amen. Beloved, you will not treat God like a doormat and think you can receive the mysteries from him. Who treats you poorly and you still give them your pearls and your gold, and you still unveil to them the deep concerns of your heart? Who does that? None of us guaranteed. And the reason why I can be reassured of that is because we are created in the image of God. If God will not do it, do not deceive yourself that you can do it. You will do it at
Amen.
Your own.
Amen.
If somebody humbles themselves before you, somebody respects, honors you, there is a degree of mysteries about yourself that you unveil to them. But if somebody will treat you poorly all the time, beloved, there is very little that you have to get to do with them. It's the law of honor. If you want to honor people, you need to respect them. Amen? That's one of the ways we show honor. It doesn't matter the age of the person. Let's honor people. Let's respect them. And when you honor people, you'll be amazed what they'll release to you by virtue of your honor, the honor that they received from you. It is the same. We do so because we are created in the image of God. And that's exactly what God does for us. Amen. He has already paid the ultimate price with his son, Jesus Christ. He has already done that. That is what you and I need. Even in our disrespect, God did that. That is settled. However, when you get into the kingdom, the rules of engagement are different. Amen. If we must receive those blessings and benefit from them, then our attitude must change. Amen. God is a just God. We will be grateful when God judges injustice. Amen. So may we not find ourselves on the other side of the spectrum. Amen. Where we'll be judged by him, because he is a just God. Amen. Now, lack of reverence for God and even people who conceal our understanding. And let's take a look at a few examples. We remember, like we said on multiple occasions, that in Matthew 13, as recorded in scripture, that is when Jesus Christ began to speak in parables. Never before did he speak in parables like that. To a place where his disciples questioned him, why are you speaking in parables? It's unlike you. Right? But he began doing so because of the occurrences in Matthew 12. He began concealing understanding because of what happened in Matthew 12. Jesus Christ was disrespected. He was accused. Amen. There was no reverence shown to him. He was called the very devil himself. Amen. And because of that lack of reverence, he began to change his approach. If you abuse everything I tell you, then it's a wake-up call for you and I to change strategies. We cannot be holier than Jesus. Amen. We cannot. The Bible says in Matthew 12, 22 to 24, Jesus and Beelzebub. Then the Bible says, then they brought him a demon-possessed man who was blind and mute, and Jesus healed him so that he could both talk and see. All the people were astonished and said, could this be the son of David? But when the Pharisees heard this, they said, it is only by Beelzebul, the prince of demons, that this fellow drives out demons. Amen. While others were perplexed, thinking, could this be the son of God? I'm not quite sure, but it seems like it. The Pharisees thought they were bold and courageous, and they thought dispensing their ignorance and disobedience was the best approach. And then they now said, it is only by Beelzebul, meaning they were accusing the powers that Jesus was using to heal a demon possessed. They were attributing those powers to Beelzebul, to the prince of demons, to a place where they said, it is only by Beelzebul, the prince of demons, that this fellow drives out demons. They came to their own conclusion. They were not even like the people in the crowd who were trying to find out if he was a son of God, but they outright accused him that the powers that he's using is from Beelzebul. You can take time to read the story. Now, Jesus changed his rules of engagement. He changed his approach. In Matthew 13, the next chapter, he changed everything. The Bible now says in verse 10 through 14, it says, the disciples came to him and asked, why do you speak to the people in parables? He replied, because the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you, but not to them. Whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have, will be taken from them. This is why I speak to them in parables. Those seeing, they do not see, though hearing, they do not hear or understand. In them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah. You'll be ever hearing, but never understanding. You'll be ever seeing, but never perceiving. Amen. Beloved, are we the type who are always hearing, but never understanding? We gather on Sundays, we gather on Tuesday and on Wednesday. I don't know where else you gather on the different days of the week. Are you the type who always hears, but never understands? Could that be because of your lack of reverence for God? You may not outright call God that or Jesus Christ as the one who used demonic powers to cast out demons, but in your attitude towards kingdom agenda, could you say you give God the optimum and the maximum reverence? For as long as we continue to despise the things of God, understanding will be concealed and you forever face walls in your life that will never come down. Never, because we have chosen not to show reverence to God. And he too has also decided on the other end that if you will not respect me, I cannot throw pearls to pigs. Amen. I'll keep the secrets of the kingdom of heaven to those who desire to seek after it, to those who desire to incline their ears and their hearts to me. Amen. With respect, with reverence. So we see the consequence or the consequences of lack of reverence towards God. Amen. Understanding was concealed. So let's examine ourselves. We're giving ourselves 5 reasons tonight why understanding could be concealed. Amen. If after having examined yourself throughout all of this, and you cannot find one reason why understanding is concealed, then I call upon you to continue to pray, amen, and that door of understanding will be opened up to you for the glory of the Lord, amen. Now, still talking about lack of reverence, the Bible says in Psalm 25, verse 14, the Lord confides in those who fear him, meaning in those who have reverence for him. The Bible says he makes his covenant known to them. He confides in those who have reverence for him, and he makes his covenant known to them. Amen. He confides. Do you confide in everybody? No, you don't. Why? Because you're created in the image of God. Amen. If someone does not respect you, you wouldn't confide in them. It's the same thing. You're just demonstrating the nature of God. So the Bible tells us that God himself confides in those who have reverence, reverential fear for him, and he makes his covenant known to them. Beloved, we operate with God and we relate with him by virtue of covenant, amen? You and I are seated and here and partakers of salvation by virtue of the blood covenant, amen? That is how he relates to us. There are so many mysteries attached to the body and the blood of Jesus Christ, which you and I may not have known up to this point. Why? Because probably we've not inclined our ears to it, or we just show very little reverence for him when it comes to spending time with him or just fellowshipping with him or talking about him. Yet when we have problems, we seek for all the prayers we can, we attend all the conferences we can. But beloved, do not be deceived. God is all-knowing, he's omniscient, okay? If we are doing these things because we just want to barely get by, we will not get it. I speak to you from the very heart of God, you will not get it if you're just trying to play games with God. You wouldn't get it because God knows your heart. The Amplified Version says, the secret, meaning of the sweet, satisfying companionship of the Lord, have they who fear, meaning revere and worship him. And he will show them his covenant and reveal to them its deep inner meaning. Are you a carrier of the mysteries of God? How many mysteries in your walk with the Lord has he unveiled to you? It is proof that you reverence him because he will not throw pearls to pigs. Amen. Talking again about reverence.
Amen.
Another scripture in Nehemiah 1-3. We read that earlier. And I'm going to read this all the way to verse 6 this time around. It says, talking about lack of reverence and how people incorporated reverence in order to gain understanding. Nehemiah 8 verse 1-3 on this slide says, now all the people gathered together as one one man in the open square that was in front of the water gate. And they told Ezra the scribe to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded Israel. So the Bible says, so Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly of men and women, and all who could hear with understanding on the first day of the seventh month. Then it says, then he read from it in the open square that was in front of the water gate from morning until midday before the men and women and those who could understand, and the ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. He was reading, but the people were paying attention. They were attentive. When you come to church, because we are on Zoom and you're not on camera, are you browsing your phones, checking all the Instagrams and Twitters, posting your latest picture, facing the book, Facebook, checking your emails? Yet you want God to answer you. Yet you want the mysteries of God to be unveiled to you. On what condition? These people gathered and the law was being read to them. And we are told that they paid attention. No doubt they gained understanding. Are we gathering just to fulfill all righteousness? And because we cannot see, any of us, we are not omniscient, we cannot see, we are not all powerful, nor all knowing, we cannot control what you do, you know, and all of that. We don't know what you're doing. So you do many and everything, but give attention to the word. And then at the end of the day, you check your box, oh, I attended service. Did you understand? Beloved, let's not deceive ourselves, okay? You can deceive man all you want, but in the future, your results will be a report card of your past. Amen. Do not deceive yourselves. Your future will be a report card of these days. Amen. The guarantee for us is that when we sit under the word, in a few years from now, none of us should be at the same level. If you are at the same level, it's just a report card of what probably you may have been doing. Persecutions notwithstanding, baptism of fire notwithstanding, it is evidence to those who are spiritual. If you took these days seriously, it will be very clear, even in your articulation of scripture and your understanding of it. They gave attention as the book of the law was being read to them. Now, in verse 4-6, the Bible says, so Ezra the scribe stood on a platform of wood, which they had made for that purpose. Just as we gather through Zoom, it's our own platform, the Global Discipleship platform. We gather through here for the purpose of sharing the word and the expectations that we at the other end give attention to it. And it says, and beside him at his right hand stood Matithiah, Shema, Anaya, Arijah, Hilkiah, and Maaseiah. And at his left hand, Pedaiah, Mishael, Malchijah, Hashum, Hashbadana, Zachariah, and Meshulam. So he had people standing on his left and on his right hand. The Bible now says, and Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, just like I am unveiling scriptures to us right now. For he was standing above all the people, and when he opened it, the Bible says all the people stood up. Now, we're not necessarily saying that you stand up. However, I remember that when we attended fellowship buildings, when we attended services there, in some fellowship centers, when the word of God is about to be read, they ask the people to stand up just to show reverence for God. Beloved, whatever it takes for you to demonstrate reverence to God is what you should be after. It's what you should be after. I'm not saying that when
amen.
We
read scripture, amen.
Stand up, but what will it cost you? What will it take for you to demonstrate reverence to God, both physically and spiritually or internally? Amen. Do not say salvation is personal. That's a story for the past. Amen. We've tackle that particular statement. It's personal, but it's not private. I need to see. You need to see that I reverence God physically, not even what I do in the closet or at nighttime. Amen. So the people stood up to listen to the word of God. And the Bible says, and Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God. He made sure that he gave reverence to God, just like we give reverence to God by acknowledging his body, the body and the blood of his son. Then the Bible says, then all the people answered, amen, amen, while lifting up their hands, and they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. Amen. All of these actions, the standing up, the amen and the amen, the raising up of hands, the bowing down of their heads, only to gain understanding for the word. What will it cost you, beloved? How far are you willing to go to receive understanding? Because as the story goes on from verse 7 through 8, we now begin to see how the Bible says that they gained understanding. They were helped to a place where they understood. Do you know that you can be helped and you still never understand? I can help you in an area where you despise so much. And because you despise that area, you still will not gain the understanding, even though the help is helpful and is necessary. But because you despise and you think little about the things of God, that help becomes vain help. Even though help, the same kind of help that will propel a person from point A to point Z, but to you, it may actually even cause you to regress. So beloved, we've come to the end of today. I believe that this message has found a place in your heart. And if you're the type who desires to pursue understanding, you have more than enough tools to go after it, to a place where you can boldly say, I carry the spirit of understanding for the glory of the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen, amen, amen.
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 Amen. So beloved, the floor is open for us to share our thoughts, inputs. What are you taking back with you? What do you plan to do differently?
Amen. Okay. Can I talk? Or?
Yes, sure.
The word which you just gave today, I kind of feel like you're speaking to me like particularly. I mean, you know me, I'm gonna be straightforward and honest. I do that. When sometimes it looks like sometimes when you're on, you want to get the service, that's when friends want to text you. That's when friends want to text you. Hey, what do you think about this chat? What do you think about this? The whole of that stuff is a whole distraction. I made up my mind, it looks like I'm going to be switching off my phone when it comes to service time. Like, it's either I try to do it the hard way or I don't know how I'm going to do it. Because literally prior to this service, I was trying to literally take like a little nap. Nobody sent me a text. Like nobody, like nothing was popping up. As soon as I get on the service, bunch of stuff that just like come into my phone. And new chat codes, all of that. And it's so, so difficult not to look at that. I'm telling you, the human flesh is I don't know how it is, but we really need to really dedicate. And what you said is really true, man. God knows our heart and he knows what we're looking for. And I just kind of feel like if you really don't show interest, if you really don't reject the stuff and really like concentrate on the word, like these little things that you're saying like that, like during service, you concentrate on the word and we don't look at our phones and all of that. Those are part of the understandings that we can't get. Those are some of the understandings that is going to take us like a whole while for us to really, really catch. I'm a typical example of that. I'm a suspect. In fact, I'm not a suspect, but I felt like the whole message you were talking to me, mm-hmm. I'm guilty for that. And I promise God that it's not like I'm going to change totally, but I'm going to reduce the way during services that I have to look at my phone. Also, I need to look at those stuffs. I'm going to work on it. And thanks so much, man, for the message. It's really a mind-blowing message. I really love it.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Thank you for sharing. I pray that you receive grace for divine strategies on how to change. It's possible.
Thanks, ma'am.
Good evening.
Good evening. Brother Allen.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Pastor. I did enjoy your message. I was excited when I was listening what and the message. As you were sharing, how you were teaching, I felt God rebuke on your message. Yes, I felt it. And I know myself, I have to work on patience. I know my heart is longing to know. I learned few things till now. I know I'm not satisfied by what I learned until now, because there's much to learn. I think I need to work on that part of patience. Be patient. Yes, I need to work on it. You did share about the joy of God is your strength.
Yes.
Because the Lord rejoices because the Lord of God is your strength because when we gain understanding of the word, it rejoices God's heart. And when it rejoices God's heart, we receive strength as kind of compensation. I was thinking about it, and as I was thinking about the joy of the Lord, my understanding was based on Galatians 5, verse 22-23, about the fruit of the Spirit,
yeah.
Is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity,
mm-hmm.
faithfulness, gentleness, self-control.
Yeah.
Personally, the way you explain the joy of the Lord, the joy of God is your strength. That was not how I was seeing it before. I was seeing it as when I'm sad, I know God is, Jesus is in me and is with me, because he's in me and is with me, because I know that truth. I start getting his joy. I start getting his joy in order to come out from that sadness.
Amen.
Yes. So yeah, that's my take. Thank you so much. Yes. Thank you.
You're welcome, Brother Allen. You're welcome. And if you look at the statement, the joy of the Lord is my strength, exclusive of Nehemiah 8, then your explanation is 100% correct. But if you look at it in context, then you realize that the explanation is different. And when the word of God is concerned, context is king.
Okay.
Amen.
Thank you.
I used to think about it the same way, and I still think about it the same way that you do, because it is actually correct, exclusive of Nehemiah 8.
Okay, thank you.
I'll go next. Thank you so much. This was so powerful, and I'm sure as my brothers who went before me, you know, it was speaking to all of us. And what I really got from your teaching tonight is, you know, I was just asking myself, you know, why do we lack understanding? And for me, I thought some of the things that really, you know, distractions, you know, prioritization and self-control in terms of, you know, do we, you know, we get distracted sometimes as my brother was saying, you get distracted, you know, when you're really trying to learn and to understand and then to prioritize our time to learning and meditating on the word of God and just really to have that self-control from distraction. So thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Amen, amen.
I'm gonna go ahead. So how I feel right now, I just think that the Lord came on here with a whip and whipped every one of us. I mean, the Bible says that you will rebuke those who you've broken your love. So I think it's coming from a place of love. He wants us to grow. That's what I picked from everything that we said. Well received.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much for awesome word. Something that stood out to me is when you said that understanding will keep you from making a mistake. And then it was another part you were talking to, you were saying how it will affect your life, your daily life. And, they'll call you the Jesus girl or, you know, things like that. And right before you had said that it'll cause you, understanding will stop you from making mistakes. I'm literally at work, you know, driving and delivering pizzas or whatever, but I had a problem with a manager being sarcastic and condescending and just making really like bullying remarks. But I literally turned around to say something, but understanding that first I hear them making remarks and they're not saved. And understanding that the enemy is speaking through him and wants me to react literally kept me from saying anything. I didn't even open my mouth. And then to get on the get online and hear you say that right after it happened, and then to even go more specifically and say that it'll affect how people treat you and things like that, that was right on time.
Amen. Amen. Thanks.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Any other thoughts for tonight?
Yes, amen. Sister Coco here. I thank the Lord for this wonderful teaching. And what it is to have understanding of the word of God. And the way you have started since last week till now. It's not something we are going to just tell you, Mama Mildred, we understand. No, it is a journey. Mm-hmm. Thank you for laying out all this, all that we should do, all that we should keep in mind that we are human beings, we forget. We have to go back and study. We have to go back and pay attention to our own life, how to prioritize things. I went back to last week teaching. To tell the truth, I have missed a lot of this thing you say, even that day. And today, you went even deeper. So I'm learning about understanding, but I'm not going to say I understand. I am learning, and I believe I will get there. It is a journey. It is a lot of work. Thank you for the reminder. And thank you for emphasizing so many things that we don't pay attention to. If you really, really want to understand what the word of God is talking about in season, in context, in terms to be able to explain to someone, it's not just for us, and to put into practice so that results will come out, so that we can reap tenfold, 30-fold, 100-fold. For our life to be changed, it is a lot of work. Thank you for teaching us this. And I will go back and work on it for you yourself to see that, yes, it has worked or is working. Yes, you are not just talking to us for us to come here every Tuesday and just be present. No, you want us to really work on it, implement it, change our life, change other people's life for the advancement of the kingdom of God. So it is a lot of work. Thank you for this teaching.
Amen.
So much. You said it all. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Any other thoughts before we pray?
When you come to the part where you said earlier, you said you had to gain wisdom, gain understanding.
You're muted.
You gain, when you search for the wisdom, it's like, for instance, and they had the love in it too. When you search the wisdom, it's like being coached. You gotta have the wisdom to go ahead and to have the, what do you say, the wisdom and the what? I'm sorry. Understanding.
Wisdom and understanding.
The wisdom and understanding. So like once you have the wisdom, like for instance, it's like a good player at sports. Once you have the wisdom, then you have the understanding. A coach has to coach you for that wisdom. And once you have that understanding, you can execute the plays well enough, you know what I'm saying, to lead in other directions. Well enough to be able to coach somebody else. When you are coming into an understanding of the word, you have to seek the wisdom first, then the understanding. In order to seek that wisdom, you have to be like any other relationship with your friends, your family. You gotta have a love for them. You gotta have a love for seeking Christ. And like lady said, like sister said earlier, it's not easy, and it's not going to be easy. People get distracted all the time. People get distracted from actually keeping their time with, you know. But as long as you have that yearning, that love to get the wisdom, in due time you'll get the understanding with patience.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
That's powerful. I like how you use a team as in, let's say a soccer team, you know, they acquire all the wisdom, then now they execute it to prove understanding. Because after your coach must have told you everything, how can you prove to him that what he said means something to you? It is in the establishment of it, in the executing of it, because when you execute, you're establishing, right? You're removing it from the unseen to the seen. I cannot know what you know until I see your actions, because our actions are report cards of what we know. If we
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And thank you for that powerful word also.
Thank you. Okay, so let's just pray. Let's just unmute and thank God for the word, first of all. We have three prayer points and we'll be done for the night. And let's just thank God. Father, we are grateful. We say thank you.
Thank you. Just God, we're so thankful. Glory to the light of God. Father God, we
Father, we bless you. That we have lacked for so many years. Thank you for all the wonderful things that you are doing to us. Father, I thank you, Lord, I bless you. I give you glory.
Father God,
I invest in you and change it. Father, that we will not just be the head of this world, but we can work on and improve ourselves, approved by the Holy
Spirit.
Lord, I pray for us.
Evidence in our actions. That our life is
everything
you can take. Discouragement from this mission.
The words to Moses indeed to the people of Israel. Hallelujah.
Loved, after this Thanksgiving, which I pray that we will continue to thank God, I have three prayer points for us, and my prayer points typically come in the form of verses, scriptures. Proverbs 21 verse 16 says, the man, the woman that wandereth out of the way of understanding shall remain in the congregation of the dead. I believe you and I do not cherish the congregation of the dead, be it physically dead or spiritually dead, be it dead in understanding or dead in wisdom, call it dead, whatever area. But the Bible says the person who will wander out of the way of understanding, there is one guarantee for them. They will remain in the congregation of the dead. We are going to pray and ask the Lord. We'll cry out for wisdom and understanding and cry out to the Lord and receive grace to not wander out of the way of understanding, so that our names will not be recorded in the congregation of the dead, so that we will not remain there. In whatever area of our lives that is dead, we are praying tonight to receive grace not to wander away from understanding. Psalms 103 verse 7, the Bible says, he made known his ways to Moses, his deeds to the people of Israel. God, he took time to make known his ways to Moses. If you've ever done a study in the life of Moses, you agree with me that Moses feared God. He reverenced God with everything to a place where God confided in him. So because of that reverence, God confided in him. God made known his ways. You know, we acquaint ourselves with the hands of God, not the heart of God. Amen. We acquaint ourselves with the deeds of God. This is the doing of the God. My question to us, what are the ways of God? God can only make his ways to us when we incline our hearts to him. So I want us to desire to be like Moses, the one whom God made known, not just his ways, but he also made known his deeds. Beloved, there is no way that you can know the ways of God and not know his deeds. Amen. There is no way. But you can know his deeds, but never know his ways. So our prayer tonight is that we will know both the ways of God and his deeds. Amen. And the third prayer point, or maybe the fourth, because we thanked God earlier, is Psalm 119 verse 19. It's a reminder, a scripture I hold very dearly, and I quote all the time whenever I get the chance. As a matter of fact, it's my mantra for life. The Bible says, I am a stranger on earth. Do not hide your commands from me. Beloved, until we encounter Psalms 119 verse 19, our ways will remain the highway. But I submit to you, beloved, whether we like it or not, we all are strangers on the earth. It's a given, it's a fact, amen, cannot be changed. So the moment we come to reality and accept this truth, then from that point, our lives will change. Then we will stop chasing shadows and start chasing what ought to be chased. Amen. He says, I am a stranger. Beloved, you and I are strangers on this earth, guaranteed. Now, because you're a stranger in a land that is not yours, you need the GPS, the navigation system for life. So tonight you will cry out as a stranger on planet earth that God, please, I am a stranger here. I don't know right from left, front from back. So I pray that do not hide your commands from me. Confide in me, give me understanding so I can properly navigate myself through this earth. as I await and anticipate your coming. We never fail to remind ourselves to anticipate the coming of Jesus Christ. That is why we partake of the Lord's Supper, to remind us week after week that as often as we eat of the bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he returns, meaning we anticipate a return, amen? So because you anticipate a return, because I anticipate a return, then let's live like ones who anticipate a return, amen? So let us pray. The scriptures are there. Open up your mouth and pray. If you don't want to remain in the congregation of the dead, please pray for yourself and your generation. If you want to know just, if you want to know the, both the ways and the deeds of God, pray for yourself. If you want to come to the reality that you're a stranger on this earth and you do not know, God knows it, ask him to give you, to show you his commands. Tell him that you don't want him to hide it from you. Let us pray. The prayer points have been listed. Pray for yourself.
A woman that wandered out of the way of understanding shall remain in the congregation of the dead. Papa, you forbid that I found myself in the congregation of the dead. Father, I want Father God to be on the way of understanding. Papa, I want to gain understanding. Papa, I desire the full understanding of your word, of your ways, Lord. Father, have your way in me so I can understand your things, your ways. Papa, I pray that you made known your ways unto me.
Moses, I pray.
I know, Papa, I've seen your deed and you continue to show your mighty hand strong in my life, Father.
Now, so I pray and ask you to make known your ways.
Father, thank you, Father, for reminding me that I'm a stranger on the earth. So, Lord, no hide your command from me. Father, I am a stranger on the earth. I did not bring anything and I'm not taking anything out of this earth. But, Lord, no hide your command from me. Your command is how I should go about living on earth.
I don't know the navigation system of the kingdom.
Help me, Lord, to know your ways. Help me, Father, to know your ways. Help me to know your
amen. Father, I say thank you. You be all glory, Lord. Father, we say thank you. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
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 So
amen.
Okay, it's not on the line. Sister Edima, could you pray and close us off for the night, please?
Sure. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this evening, God. We thank you for your blessings. We thank you for allowing us together tonight, God, to learn your word, God. We thank you for your daughter, God, that you have used tonight as your vessel to be able to share your word with us, God, to be able to remind us of what we need to do, God, that we should not only listen, God, we should not only hear, God, but we should be following and doing and show our deeds, God, in the way that pleases you, Lord Jesus. I thank you for everyone who has made the time to be here tonight, God, to learn. I ask you, God, to continue to help us to grow in wisdom and understanding, God, to continue to depend on you, knowing that you are the only one who's going to be able to help us, God, to gain that wisdom and gain that understanding, and that you are everything, Lord Jesus. As we go to sleep tonight, we put everyone who's on this line, God, and their families in your hands as we go to sleep, God. We ask you to guide us, God, to send your guiding angel to cover over our houses, God, and over our homes, God, to cover our homes, God, with the blood of Jesus so that we can sleep well and wake up tomorrow in good health. We ask you, God, to forgive our sins, God, for those that we have done in words, for the sins that we have done, God, in what we have thought, our deeds, and in any other way that we have done, God, without our own will, God. We bless you and glorify you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.